Okay, so I'm really excited to welcome our two presenters tonight. I'll tell you a little bit about them. Tom Krott is a long-term volunteer at the Northwest Railway Museum. He's currently a docent and leads tours at the Railway Museum's train shed, and he'll tell you a little bit more of the details about what he does there. And Michael Sullivan, seated to his right, is a principal with Artifacts, a historical preservation firm. And he is an adjunct professor at the University of Washington, Tacoma. He teaches history and urban studies, and he's also on the board of HistoryLink. Okay, so please welcome to the podium, Tom Krott.
Very happy to see that we have one of the larger crowds that they've experienced down here. As I mentioned, I've been with the Railway Museum Northwest Railway Museum for 30 plus years right now, and in that time I've been train crew, maintenance of track. I've done a lot of work on some of the equipment up there. I've sold tickets. I've kind of done just about everything there is to do up there, and that's what kind of makes the whole thing fun. First of all, I'd like to take a minute just to dedicate this speaking tonight to my dear friend Buddy, who left us this last week. Tonight I want to talk a little bit about, and again this is a brief history because this is something you could go on and on and on for hours on, but a brief history of the main railroads in the state of Washington, that being the Northern Pacific, Great Northern, and the Seattle Lakeshore and Eastern, and if there's any time available at all, we'll go into the Milwaukee Road. A little bit of first background about some of the transcontinental railroads. The very first railroad in America was the Baltimore and Ohio and Railroad East, the Bapanoa, which was back in 1930, which was a very stately 16 miles long. It eventually went much longer than that. Railroad mileage in the 1850s, when railroad really started to expand, was a very small 9,000 miles, but by the end of that decade, it was almost 30,000+ miles. And the railroad mileage in this country peaked 1916, and it peaked in 19 Washington as well. Peaked in the 1916 nationally at 255,000 miles, and in the state of Washington at a little over 5,500 miles. And by that time, the U.S. in the 1850s, the U.S. had more track mileage than all the other countries in the world, but only had 5% of the population. The idea of a transcontinental railroad had been around for a long time, but it was really the gold rush in 1849 that really got things going. And it was the Civil War delayed this, certainly by any number of years. But as we all know, the first transcontinental railroad, Union Pacific, Central Pacific, was completed at Promontory, Utah in 1869 with the proverbial golden spike and so on and so forth. A great many books have been written about this. There's, I know, at least several movies, and perhaps I think one of my favorite books that have been written on this subject and was done a year or two ago is called The Great American Railroad War. And what I like about this particular one, all the others, or so many of the others, have dealt with the engineering aspects and the heroics and the difficulties and things of this sort. But this particular book dealt more with the politics of it. And it's, I think it's probably one of the best there, because it really gets into the some of the financial shenanigans that the railroads were very much want to do. Oddly enough, the gold rush also spurred another railroad, and this one I kind of came across just fairly recently. It was the Panama Canal Railroad, and the whole idea was again to get equipment going from east to west. Because remember, the NP and the GN came from the Midwest and came out west. Okay, on the Union Pacific, Central Pacific, you had stuff coming from both directions. Okay, to get the stuff to San Francisco, well, you could take the long way around the South America, or you could take the Panama Railroad across the 48 miles and shorten the trip considerably. And this is kind of like, you know, one of these footnote things, you know, very small in miles, but tremendous significance. And I think what's significant about that, again, it helped to build our transcontinental. And then when they say You know, Panama Canal Railroad, Panama Railroad, was the first transcontinental railroad in North America. Well, I think they're taking a little bit of a license there, because I never really considered Central America, the country of Panama, as North American. But if they were to say the Americas, okay, I would go along with that. But and there was only, the railroad didn't exist there very long, but then our transcontinental came along. But I think what's significant about that, again, this has helped create ours, and it was just short of the number of years after that, that the canal was built. Okay, the canal followed the original railroad route. And to this day, how do ships get through the Panama Canal? By a railroad. You know, this is something, a very small footnote in the railroad history, but I think something has lasting impact from the 1849 to today. Okay, looking at the development of railroads coming into the Washington, there's several significant things about how they came in here. If you look at how the railroads developed in California, how they did in Oregon, and how they did in Washington, terribly, terribly different. Washington had several things going for it, one of which was the Spokane area, and I should really say the Spokane Valley in the Columbia River. Now, when you look at it, you had very, very gentle terrain. You had great climate. Okay, down in Oregon, you did not have that. You had the mountains, to be sure, but you had a lot of high desert. Okay, if you look at California, okay, again, this is the very same thing. And what's significant about this is that if you look at the states then, or even today, there's no population center in the eastern part of the states. There still isn't. Nor do they have something as natural as the Columbia River. And again, something that, if you look at the map right now, something that they still don't have. And I guess it's no coincidence that eight of the eventual transcontinental railroads, three of them came through the Spokane area. And that's a fairly good percentage. Again, it's because the natural gifts that we were able to have. Northern Pacific Railroad was the first one to come through. In 1853, a number of survey teams were sent out, one of which was Isaac Stevens, the territorial governor and a surveyor by a train, was to be one of the more important of the surveyors there. And logic, again, as we look back, logic would say that the easiest pass to go over would be Snoqualmie. Okay, it's considerably lower than any of the others, and the Cascades at that point are much narrower, probably about 50 miles compared to some of the others, though it was as much as 100 miles. And when the NP was talking about this, there were any number of cities that thought they had the best chance, and we've all heard these kind of little arguments before. These cities include Olympia, Steilacoom, Port Townsend, Seattle, and Fairhaven, Bellingham. And Seattle would have certainly been the most logical choice because, well, number one, it was the largest, it had the greatest industrial base, it had the most natural deep water port. But ultimately was not picked. The city of Tacoma was picked as the terminus for the NP in 1972. At that time, there were only perhaps 100 to 200 people in the town, but land was so much cheaper there than it would have been in Seattle. And my own opinion is that railroads frequently made more money on land speculation than they did on moving a lot of material. And I think this is a lot of it. And you could simply say that Seattle was priced, simply priced itself out of the market. Okay, needless to say, Seattle was a little taken back by this whole thing. And the feeling was, if they're not going to come to us, we'll go to them. Okay, there were a number of volunteer groups that got together. And you'll recognize some of the names. In fact, the first steam engine that came on here was the A.A. Denny. And I wish I had a good photograph of it. And you can, we all know the name, the Denny family. But they built a small railroad, narrow gauge railroad, called the Seattle and Walla Walla, a railroad and transportation company in 1973. And this would eventually be absorbed by the NP several years later. They had extremely little railroad expertise, but even less financial expertise. But this was a very viable railroad for a number of years, because what they did, they set this up to haul coal out of Renton. And this was later, they had an extension to to Newcastle, which was a small extension across, and then that coal was transported across the lake, Lake Washington, to downtown Seattle. In downtown Seattle, on the waterfront, there were any number of coal docks, and there were many tons of it. I've heard that this extended at one point in time as far as Black Diamond, but I've never really seen any real documentation on that. The NP route that they chose, okay, they came from the Spokane area, then they came down through on what was then the Spokane or the Oregon Navigation Railroad Company down to Pasco. That railroad already existed, so that kind of gave them a little bit of a head start. And coming across, where they needed to come across the Cascades, again, they had these five survey crews that were looking out there, and they went as far, actually a little bit further north of Snoqualmie Pass, but they ultimately chose one that was originally called the Green River Pass. About a week or two prior to that, it was actually called Grant's Pass because it was just right after President Grant had just been inaugurated. But it came to be called Stampede Pass. What had happened there is that one of the construction crews was, shall we say, slacking off, and they were fired, and they left en masse from the location, and one of them put up a little sign on one of the trees, left in Stampede, and therefore that Stampede name has been there ever since. Great Northern, okay, the second transcontinental that came through, who? Great Northern and James Hill. History has been much, much kinder to the Great Northern and James Hill for any number of reasons, one of which, and I talked a little bit about some of the land speculation and some of the grabbing and the land grants and things of this sort, which were subject to a tremendous amount of abuse. Okay, James Day Hill did not use that. Okay, he did his own financing, and he avoided a lot of the scandals that many of the others were to have. James Day Hill was born in Canada, and I think this influenced a lot of the things that he did later on as well, because, well, for example, even the first name of his railroad was the St. Paul, Minneapolis in Manitoba. And his original ideas was to tie in more with some of the Canadian facilities than it ever was out west. However, as the NP was being built, there were a great many people that were complaining about this. And this is really what spurred the Great Northern to build a railroad in the first place. And it was some of this land speculation, some of the financial shenanigans that were going on. And this is what actually led to the Interstate Commerce Commission to get involved in 1887. 1889, James Day Hill decided to reach the Puget Sound. And to kind of reflect what he was doing right now, he named his railroad the Great Northern Railroad. And where he got that name was based off a railroad in the back in England that had one of the best reputations of any of the operating railroads at the time. So therefore, he adopted this name, and I think this very much reflects what he was trying to do too, is to build a transcontinental railroad. And it certainly reflected more of his vision as well. Again, I mentioned the fact that he was Canadian, and I think this had an influence on his route as well, because he took a much more northerly pass along the, in fact, it roughly today follows the Highway 2 coming across the country. And they came across, certainly was what we know as Stevens Pass right now. Okay, a lot of people, I think, originally had the impression that was named after the governor, Isaac Stevens. However, it was not. It was based off one of their surveyors, a gentleman by the name of John Stevens. And, it was, with all due modesty, he named this after himself. And he did this a lot of other things too, but back in Montana, he tried to name a lot of passes and things after himself. And he was very proud of himself. And Great Northern eventually came into Everett as opposed to Seattle, although there were a little bit later, there were some branch lines. And one term that we always associate with the Great Northern is the Empire Builder. And however, to my surprise, this was never really given a name to one of their long-distance trains until 1929. And fortunately, that name still sticks, and you know, Amtrak is still using that as one of the, in fact, I think it's almost one of the longest longest running trans, or you know, of the Amtrak's run right now. Okay, Seattle Lakeshore and Eastern. In fact, let me go to one of the maps here. I like this map, but there's almost too much information on here. I tried to find one that just had the major roads on here, you know, the Great Northern, Northern Pacific, and the Milwaukee Road. However, what I like about this, and the age on this is around 1910. But what it shows, all these, in fact, at that time, there were approximately 500 railroads in the state of Washington. So you can just get an idea how many of those there actually were. Now, to be sure, a great many of those were just logging railroads, you know, short logging railroads. But you can see the vast intersection, intersection of roads, you know, across the state. Again, we talked a little bit about NP coming across Stampede Pass, and the I said it's probably about maybe 100, 125 miles or something like that north. And of course, when both of them came across the mounds, initially they did the switchbacks until they could build the tunnels, and in fact, even rebuild the tunnels a little bit later on. Seattle Lakeshore and Eastern Railroad. Again, this is one of these. Ideas, if they're not going to come to us, we're going to go to them. Okay, Seattle had been spurred both by the Great North and by the NP. So therefore, okay, we'll make one more attempt to build our own railroad with the idea of going across Snoqualmie Pass, again, the easier of all of them, and tie in to Eastern Washington, principally the Walla Walla area, and thereby hopefully tying in with one of the majors down there. Well, that was not just wishful thinking, because at that time, the Union Pacific was also making a lot of noises about coming up through a northerly route, and that would have certainly would have tied in with that, and that was the general idea. However, what happened, the UP came up that way, but where did they go? They went through the Columbia Gorge, again, the most natural railroad thoroughfare ever, and it was kind of, you know, sorry, Seattle. Okay, the Seattle Lakeshore and Eastern came through downtown Seattle. Okay, we can see Lake Union, Issaquah coming out through here. They went as far as Tanner, where they simply ran out of money. And it was a very viable railroad for quite a number of years. However, several years later, the Seattle Lakeshore and Eastern simply ran out of money and was picked up as part of the NP. And the NP didn't really want to buy it, but the only reason they bought it was to keep, we don't want Great Northern coming in. And so therefore, a lot of the effort that would have gone into expanding that, to improving it, completely fell by the wayside. I know we'll be talking about one of the other depots here in a couple of minutes, but this is the Snoqualmie Depot, 1890. It's still very much there. I think it's one of the more elegant buildings. And why did we have this very elegant building compared to the depots in North Bend or Issaquah? Okay, Issaquah is still there, the original building. The North Bend is long gone. But the whole idea was, again, they were had great ideas, but terribly underfinanced. Okay, they built this beautiful building to create the illusions of how lucky we really are, how, you know, to attract a lot of investments. And it's interesting, this building right here is still there. It's the Woodsman Inn right now. And that I'm sure everybody has been by there at one time or another. One of the facilities that we have up there is the as our train shed exhibition area. And this is some of the equipment. I know there's a lot of times people will say you've got all this equipment out there kind of sitting in the weather and so forth. But because of this facility that we've had a little over 2 years now, we've been able to get pieces of equipment like this and bring it inside and put it on proper display. For example, the caboose here was originally built, I'm going to say sometime in the very 1940s, but this was completely redone at a cost of about 5,000 volunteer hours. And now the locomotive here was actually one of our main power sources for a number of years, and it's been hidden in here right now, completely restored. We could fire that thing up tomorrow if we really needed to. Inside our train shed there, 25,000 square feet, there's about 1,200 feet of track, but it's allowing us to bring a lot of this equipment inside and get it out of the weather. We operate 5 miles of track. The Seattle Lakeshore and Eastern Railroad probably had about 46, 47 miles an hour, so there's all that's 5F left. How many people do we move on our little 5 miles of track every year? For the last several years, we've had in the numbers of 47,000 per year. So that's a lot of times up and down the track. And we probably operate somewhere around 50 days a year right now, to, you know, holidays and so forth, and the Christmas tree and so forth. And of course, we're shut down right now for the season, but we'll start up again here in April. And again, this is one of the ideas. Okay, if they're not coming to us, we'll go to them. But this was kind of the Seattle's second attempt to do something like this, and this was just a little bit more successful than the first one. And we do offer tours of this, too. I'm one of the people that put together a program where we have about 15-20 minutes of the different equipment that we have inside there, and would certainly encourage any of you and all of you to come up and not only ride our equipment this next year, but to come by, and we'll do one of the tours. Thank you.
Yeah, I think it was about the fifth grade. I was sitting in Sister Mary Eunice's class, and she was going to teach us about photosynthesis. And she's drawing this painful picture on this slate blackboard of a maple leaf. And I looked out the window, and right outside the window was this huge tree with about a million real maple leaves on it. And I thought, why don't we just go out there and look at the real thing? And I was kind of thinking that tonight. Because here we are at MOHAI, and it would be so easy just to be at King Street, because that's what I'm going to talk about, is King Street Station tonight. This really is, I should just tell you, for the last 3 years, my firm and myself personally have been involved in the renovation of this building, one of the really great buildings in the Northwest. Let me have the handheld one. That's great. Thank you very much. Anyway, I've been working on the renovation, and probably all of you have been watching this three-year process, most of which has been hidden behind construction fences and stuff, and now you're able to go inside and get a look at this spectacular building. And what I wanted to talk a little bit about tonight was the process we went through, what happened behind those drapes over the last 3 years. And because we were the preservation consultants on this, it was our wonderful job to get to spend a lot of time looking into the history, the physical, and the story behind this building. So I wanted to talk a little bit about that as well. King Street Station was designed by a firm called Reed & Stem. They were based in St. Paul, Minnesota, and they did most of the railroad stations for the Northern Pacific Railroad, but also did construction for other railroads around the country. Most noticeably, this project happens in 1906, but in 1913, they will design Grand Central Station in New York. And if any of you are following the tragedy, the preservation tragedy going on in Detroit, you know that the centerpiece of the problems in Detroit is their Grand train station. The Detroit train station is just a national treasure, and it is so sad to see the condition it's in. But that's a Reed & Stem building. And Tacoma's Union Station, which was finished in 1911, it's also a Reed & Stem project. These guys really knew their stuff. They were elegant architects, and they were in the lower Great Lakes country. And their projects, especially in this era, reflect the influence of the Columbian Exposition in 1893. probably a lot of you, you're all historians, you know how important the 1893 World's Fair was in Chicago. It really changed the way that American cities and cities all over the world were shaped after that in 1893. And these guys followed that Beaux-Arts, that great white city, as Eric Larson, the local writer, calls it. I won't talk about his book and how much I love it because it would reflect on my shallow interest in prurient popular history, because every other chapter is about a mass murderer. But in between, the historical story he tells is fascinating about the building of the Columbia and the World's Fair. But King Street is very much in that era. It's a product of the ideas that come out of Chicago. And one of the other big ideas for historians that come out of Chicago was a young Harvard historian, actually University of Wisconsin historian at the time, Frederick Jackson Turner, who would read a paper on the frontier thesis, the idea that the essence of America's story comes out of the West. And after that, the idea that it's from the West that we create our identity. And he kind of says, the frontier is over. Now we're building a nation, and it's in the West. And that's exactly the spirit and the influence that we see in the work of Reed and Stem, and the railroad builders that, after the Civil War, are going to be the people that are going to push our country all the way to the Pacific. Those are the big ideas behind King Street. Let's see if I can get this to move forward here. But before I get into King Street, the building of King Street Station, Tom talked about the coming of the Great Northern Railroad, the Northern Pacific Railroad, which hits Tidewater at Tacoma in 1873. And there's a lot of jealousy and stuff going on between the cities, Tacoma and Seattle. But by 1900, J.J. Hill, who builds the Great Northern, also takes over the many times bankrupt Northern Pacific Railroad, and by 1900, he controls both railroads, and so they work as one entity under one mind. Also in 1900, it's important that the Northern Pacific Railroad was a land-grant railroad, meaning that they were collecting millions and millions, 40 million acres between the Great Lakes and the Pacific Ocean that they would end up owning. And the timberland they owned in the Cascades was ancient forest, beautiful Douglas fir and western red cedar. And they struck a deal in 1900, J.J. Hill, with his next door neighbor on Sunset Avenue in St. Paul, one Frederick Weyerhaeuser, who purchases 900,000 acres of timberland in 1900. So suffice to say, J.J. Hill is a man of influence, controlling two transcontinental railroads coming into Puget Sound, and his pockets full of the wealth of the sale and the ongoing relationship with the Weyerhaeuser Company. Now he decides they're going to come into Seattle, and their line, the main line coming over the Northern Pacific, has gone into Tacoma, and the Great Northern has gone into Everett. Now they got to go into Seattle. And the first idea is to go along railroad, which is basically the waterfront. And Hill gets a hold of a big wharf and a big piece of property at the base of Jackson Street on the waterfront. A sort of difficult city engineer intercedes and says, you know, build the railroad, the waterfront is already a mess. There's like 16 rail lines running parallel on the waterfront. It's a chaotic mess. You come in and build a big train station, and we are going to be screwed. So, you know, we got to look at this differently. I got a great idea. Let's build a tunnel. Let's build a mile-long tunnel underneath the heart of the city and build this great new train station at the northern portal. So down on the waterfront, down on Elliott, way north of the downtown, they decide to strike into the muck. And then come out at Jackson Street, which was actually an old ancient shelf to a shoreline that came through there. There was a bit of a kind of a high bank there, and the idea would be that they would tunnel underneath the city and come all the way across. Took them almost 2 years, about a year and 10 months, to be able to build the tunnel. It was about almost exactly half the size of the tunnel Bertha's digging right now. And it took them about half the time to build. Although we don't know, it could be a quarter of the time when we get done. We still don't know the answer, but according to some kind of rough figuring on a cocktail napkin, it's going to be about half the time. Now that makes sense because the benefit, one thing that Bertha has is Bertha's only digging from one way all the way through. And the Great Northern Tunnel had crews digging from north and south, meeting in the middle. And they hit it right on when they finally hit. But it was hand dug, the whole thing, and then they used little electric engines to be able to pull the muck out. But they hand dug the whole thing. It was started in 1904, finished in end of 1904, and then immediately they started building King Street Station at the south portal of the Great Northern Tunnel. That's the portal today. You probably recognize where it is. You kind of know where it is. It was concrete lined, quite a marvel in its day. In fact, when it was done, it had the same claim to fame that we have for the tunnel that's under construction now. It's the biggest tunnel in the world. Not the longest, but the biggest diameter tunnel in the world when it's built. So. These shots are from a website called Recaptured City. If you've never been to it, it merges historic images with modern images, reproduces and blends them together. So this is the conductor, the station master at King Street when it opened, and these are just some views of the station when it was finished in 1906. It took about a year and a half to build. The renovation that we just got done, following the same schedule of old versus new in terms of timing, it took about twice as long to do the renovation as it did to build the building in the first place. So, you know. When it was designed, the idea was it would be the finest materials they could have. But for those of you that know about the Chicago World's Fair, it was all built out of lath and plaster and stick. It was like a movie set. And they just burned it down after the World's Fair was over. It was 6 months the fair was on. Three weeks after that, it burned down. It was gone. Here, they built to last. So the base, the ground floor of the building was poured in a modern new material, concrete. And then that was clad in granite, cascade granite. And then marble on the inside, which was claimed in all the advertising, white Italian marble quarried at the Tokine Quarry in Alaska, which was connected by the steam line that the Northern Railroad controlled. So they brought the marble down from Alaska. By the way, it's the same marble that's used at the state capitol in the 1920s. Tokine is a beautiful material. And we had to fill in a little bit with Italian marble on this project. And it's really not as interesting a material. Tokine marble is just a much more beautiful than the Carrara that we got from Italy to complete the project. I don't have much time, and I wanted to just kind of talk a little bit about some of the highlights of the project we have. And I'll go back and forth between what was original, how the building was built originally, and then how we were able to get it back, how we were able to do restoration, and in some case, change it. One of the remarkable things about the renovation of King Street Station is that when we finished the project, it was granted a LEEDS Platinum rating. It's the first National Historic Building in the city, that National Register site, that's LEEDS Platinum. And one of the things that we did to get to platinum was to reactivate original designed passive energy systems that were already in place that had been shut off over the years and displaced over the years. So a lot of the achievement of getting back to platinum was just the restoration of systems within the building that were part of the original design. So that was pretty cool. One of the big differences was that It originally, as you might imagine, had a big boiler in the basement that burned fuel like the locomotives that came and went. Over the years, that was replaced with electrical systems. We went back to radiators and hot water, but instead of boilers to find the hot water, there's a geothermal well field that was dug underneath the building. And we're pulling the heat necessary to run through the hot water radiators through heat exchangers that are using the very stable temperature of moisture at 150 or 200 feet down into the ground. So there's a field of wells underneath the building that now are used for the hot water that we use for heating and cooling in the building, both. For every dollar we spent on restoration of historic fabric in the building, we spent $3 on engineering and seismic upgrading, because it's a brick masonry building with steel frame, the original steel frame design, but it's sitting on a fill, and the idea is in a major earthquake like Nisqually, or worse than Nisqually, because it got through Nisqually just fine, but worse than that, it's not a place for public assembly. It wouldn't be safe as a hub for a high-speed rail corridor. So a huge amount of money was spent on the engineering. This building is really unique in the engineering design in that the engineers approached it as a freestanding building, like a structure on a raft. So in a major earthquake, when the ground underneath it liquefies, the whole building is designed to move independent as a unit and just float on whatever happens. So you'll see some of the steel that goes into this building. It's really amazing the amount of structure that went into designing it. And then just, this is just a diagram that shows some of the other aspects, but I want to just kind of show those to you. So this is 1910 at the beginning, 2010, at the beginning when we came to the project. Some roofing had already been done, so some minor project had been done. And the compass room, if you know, when you walk in, the compass room on the King Street level, that square room, which is actually the ground floor of the tower that goes all the way up, that had been completely renovated by a previous project that basically took a mold, a kind of a poor quality mold off the old plaster, and then created fiberglass panels that reproduce the detailing on the walls and ceiling. And then they did kind of, Home Depot quality sheet metal light fixtures that were kind of lame. They looked sort of good, but in general, that part of it was not done right. But that was the part that people saw, and it looked better than what was inside. Inside, what we saw, this is a view from a little peephole off the balcony looking out over the ceiling that was on the main waiting room. And my friend Alan Stein, Alan and Paula, who wrote the book on the Seattle World's Fair, connected for me. In 1962, for the Chicago World's Fair, they renovated the waiting room at King Street Station for all the people coming by train to the World's Fair. And what they basically did was strip everything that was out of there, everything that was historic out of there. So all the marble paneling that ran all the way around the room was all removed. Any decorative plaster was all removed. They brought a drop ceiling down with light fixtures fixed in it and made it look like really cool 1962 inside. So if any of you remember, when you went in there like 5-6 years ago, you had this kind of really worn out 1962 bad finishes. And the only thing that really reminded you of anything grand was the terrazzo floor that was kind of left in place. But everything else had pretty well been either sealed off or obliterated entirely. Now this looks really scary, but actually above this fake drop ceiling, everything's pretty much intact. The only thing they did was they drilled up through the plaster ceiling in order to put in wires to suspend the fake ceiling down inside. So that's what we sort of had. And one of the things, and then on the plaza on Jackson, the old grand wagon turnaround, which was built for horses and stuff, had all been closed over, asphalted over, and this is what it looked like on Jackson, if you remember. And these Gumby fixtures, these great light fixtures with the glass on the outside, had all been cut down and a sort of metal fence had been made around it. One of the first things that happened was that deck came off at Jackson Street to allow us access to bring in the big augers so we could drill the well field to be able to put in the heating system. And when the ceiling came out, when the fake ceiling came out, this is what we ended up with, this sort of Janus kind of treatment where you've got half 1962 and up from there 1906, pretty much intact. So we were lucky. And then this was the balcony level, which you can't really see in these pictures, but this was all CMU blocked in. So this corridor was completely closed from the overlook out over the main waiting room. And this, there were two of these big, beautiful panels that still were there, but the rest of them had all been blown out during remodels in 1950s and the 1960s. So this image will reappear because the transformation on that level is a favorite of mine in the building. So. This will just give you an idea of what was going on in terms of the steelwork inside, and I just threw this in. On every surface on the inside, in order to get to seismic, to the seismic upgrade standards we needed, these are iron steel beams, and that's inch-thick steel plate in between. So that entire wall, this is the wall between the women's waiting room and the main waiting room. This shows the original structure. This is all steel plate with steel vertical I-beam columns all the way around the room. And this was the way that the building was originally built, with concrete pans. These are, they took a metal pan, put it in place, used it as a form, poured concrete on top of it, and that engineering shape is really, really strong, and all of that stayed in place, so none of that went away. Oh, let me just, if I can get this to go back. This shows a section of the wall in the main room that just shows the plaster is attached to metal lath, expanded metal lath, which is floated away from the brick masonry wall in the building. And one of the issues was to get all of this steel to be able to fit in that cavity. So when we got done, the plane of the restored plaster is exactly where it was originally. So you can't see any of the steel when you go in there. I'm going to run out of time, so I'm going to just whip through these. This, a little ways into the project, here's some more steel. That green material is the steel. You can see the plaster that's still in place, and some of the patching of the holes is in place. Here's the welders working. These just dramatic shots. I mean, days where you'd go in there and there would be this sort of flickering light of the welding torches. That's where that print, that pink hue is coming from, as these guys are putting in the iron all the way around before we can put the plaster back. Everything from here down, this section up is panel pieces that we put back in place, that we took off and put back. Everything from here down had to be reproduced. Early on in the project, it turned out that the market collapsed, the real estate market collapsed, and all these home builders that were going to put in marble cabinet or kitchen counters suddenly weren't building, and there was a surplus of marble. We ended up being able to buy all the marble to be able to restore the down below at about 10% of what the budget was. So we ended up, it was almost cheaper to do that. So it's all original marble. That was great. This is up in the tower. All of the plaster that had to be reproduced, we worked with Evergreen Studios out of New York. They're the plaster people. Most of the 40 people on the job doing plaster every day were local artisans, though. They were just overseen by Evergreen. So we have some great Eastern Europeans and Hispanic workers who have worked with plaster all their lives. They did amazing work. But on the third level of the tower, we took the original mold, the original pieces that were used to make the molds that reproduced everything, that were beautifully made originals, we created an archive, which is stored on the third level. So if you go up in the tower, there's the archive of all the original plaster pieces. Every ornament is stored on the third floor, perfect copies, because the molds won't last forever. So we saved the originals, so we have that record. The Howard clock on the top, the Howard table clock, the E. Howard table clock from Boston from 1906, completely restored. We put an electric motor in it now so you don't have to go up every 72 hours and wind it. But anyway, it's still completely restored. I'm going to run out of time, so I'm just going to whip through this. All this original tile work, some of it 24 karat gold, we reproduced from Italy. We found a studio in Italy that was able to reproduce it. I brought a bunch of those tiles with me if somebody wants to look at the things. And this is the way we finally got. This is the kind of finish we got to at the end. Here's my corridor again. Here's the way it looked when we got done. This is the waiting room with the great drop ceiling and everything. This is the way it looks today in that same place. This is looking down from the balcony down onto the room down below after the ceiling came out. And this is the way it looked right before we opened. And Bo, if I can just take 2 minutes, I got one last story I got to tell you. This is just so satisfying for a preservationist. This is so cool. So we discovered that when they first got in there, even Evergreen Studios said, wait a minute, you know, when we investigated the paint treatment on the original plaster in the ceiling, we discovered that it was high gloss enamel put over linseed oil that was hand rubbed, and then they put three coats of enamel in bright white color, which doesn't sound stylish at all. And Evergreen said, well, everybody's using kind of a semi-gloss or a matte, it's what's stylish, you know, you sure you want to go there? We said, you know, it's what was there originally, and yeah, we're going to do that. So we dug in on it. When we got into it a little bit and we reproduced the light fixtures and got into the LED lights that replaced the original light fixtures, we discovered that entire design of that high gloss walls was done that way because in 1906, this was an ultra-modern building that was using incandescent lights, but they were very poor-performing iron filament incandescent lights that put out an incredible amount of heat and very little light. So they're very inefficient. So one of the ways that they jacked up the lighting capacity of the low-level lights was by creating a high reflective ceiling and these huge flat pools that reflected the low light performance and gave and lit the whole room well at night. So what we ended up discovering was that because we had the high reflective quality, we could meet the code required light levels with extremely high performing low light LEDs. So one of the ways we got to platinum was because the walls are reflective, the white walls. And the walls themselves, that 106-year-old trick for being able to get illumination in a big room, ended up getting us to platinum at the end of the project. So so when you go in there, if you don't like the overly white, glossy walls, there's a reason, and maybe you'll like it better. I love it when I go in there. So. Anyway, I'm sorry I ran long, Bo, wherever you are. But I know we're going to take questions, so.
Questions? Yes, in front. The question is, what was the budget for the restoration project? Who paid for it?
This is part of the part funding through the federal high-speed rail corridor. Eventually, this will be a major station in a high-speed rail. So the biggest partner is the Federal Transportation, FTA. It's about $55 million went into the project to renovate it.
Can you talk Can you comment on the light fixtures? You just kind of mentioned it, but you didn't say what they are or how you reproduce them or if they're original or whatever.
They were all gone. We had fragments of them. I could have, if we had more time, we had pieces, kind of this, we had a brass room that was just the sort of room we found up in the attic that had all these sort of rough parts that were all cast bronze. They're all beautiful, heavy bronze material. And we worked with a leak out of Portland, and using historic photographs, reproduced all the light fixtures. These big chandeliers are great. They're really beautiful. And there was a picture in the very first slide that showed the original chandelier underneath the station master. But the ones that are really spectacular are these light fixtures that march all the way around the level of the sconces on the lower level. Right below the sconces is a course of glass and gold tile mosaic runs all the way around it. That's all original. There's probably 12 or 1,400 running feet of mosaic in the building, and we probably had maybe 40 feet maximum when we started the project, so everything else had to be reproduced.
The question is, the railroad in Seattle, did that go along the Burke-Gilman Trail?
Yes, it did. Remember, the Seattle Shore and Eastern Railroad started downtown Seattle, came through Lake Union, now the University of Washington campus, along what is now the Burke-Gilman Trail, through Bothell, Kenmore, Woodinville. And why the Burke-Gilman Trail? Okay, those were named after two, actually there were a number of the founders of the Seattle Shore and Eastern Railroad, both one of which was the Denny family, of course. But it was also a Mr. Burke, Mr. Gilman. Both were Seattle attorneys. One of them later became a judge. But when the railroad was pulled up, I believe it was in the early 70s, 71, 72, they named that part of the original railroad after him.
Now, I was under the impression that it was like a small gauge railroad.
The question was that a small gauge or a full size rail line?
No. The Seattle Shore and Eastern Railroad was a full size. The only narrow gauge that I remember aware of that was built in the immediate area was the Seattle Walla Walla. I talked about the coal mine one. That's the only narrow gauge that I'm aware of. But no, the Seattle Lakeshore and Eastern area was standard gauge, yes.
The station, isn't it easy to see the difference between the two marbles?
Is it easy to see the difference between the two different types of marble in King Street Station?
I don't think so. I think it's pretty good. If you look carefully, you can see because the honing on the outside is a little more worn, but the actual grain and color of it is pretty good. The one thing is that it's book matched in some places, you know, where there's twin pieces that are sloped down the middle and polished on each side. And some of the places where there should be a book match, it's only one side. But it's something to go and look at, see what you think. I think it came out fabulous. I think it really looks good.
Do you know if they offer tours of the King Street Station?
Are there tours of King Street Station?
Most of the areas that the restoration is, 90% of the areas where the restoration happened is open to the public, so you can walk around and see it. But I don't think anybody's doing tours. I mean, I've kind of done walking tours for like Historic Seattle or History Linkers up once in a while, but there's no regular tours I'm aware of.
This goes with that. Is there a website, or will there be, that has some of these process photos that has kind of the history, or not the history, but what you guys did in restoration?
Is there a website available that shows some of these photos showing what was done or what was accomplished in the restoration?
Will there be?
Or will there be?
So when I was in about the fifth grade, Sister Mary Eunice. Sorry.
In the back.
Yes, could you talk a little bit about the extent to which there was documentation for what you were doing, or how much you had to figure out, and maybe some of the stories about how you figured out what they had done and how to replicate it?
The question is for the King Street restoration, how much of the original nature of the building was documented, and how much did they have to figure out?
There was lots of photographs and there were lots of fragments in the building, but that was the evidence we had to work from. We didn't have an original set of drawings, but we had fragments of the original drawings, and actually buildings from this era, they would sketch in roughly an ornament or a detail, and then the artisans would actually design it. So even if we'd had the drawings, it wouldn't be as valuable as having an actual fragment that we could reproduce. And there were no significant pieces of the building, no plaster ornament or light fixture or tile piece that we didn't have at least enough of a fragment that we could work from and reproduce with precision.
Did you also give the less public areas the same treatment, like behind the ticket counters and where the conductors rested and things of that nature?
Were the less public areas of the station given the same treatment as the public areas?
Well, the project right now is just basically to deal with the train use area. So like the women's waiting room is unfinished right now. It was a grand space and we have part of the ceiling. When you go to King Street today, when you walk in on the King Street level, you can look into this room that is right at the end of King Street that is closed off right now, and it's incomplete. But what we did on a big full-size 75-foot long, 30-foot high drape, we reproduced the drawing. We did have a drawing of the elevation of that wall, and so that's hanging in there against a ruined wall, so you could look through the window, see the plaster ceiling, and see that drawing showing what that wall will be like. But some areas that are not currently used are not finished in the building. They were not done as part of the project. So.
Thank you. I'm afraid that's all the time that we have, so please join me in thanking Michael and Tom.